previous episode that especially as a student, it's easy to get the impression that languages are unchanging things, fixed in time with some sort of perfect standard that we ruin all the time. This is very untrue. It seems to be a fact in our world that human languages change, sometimes more slowly or quickly, but all human languages change, no exceptions. In fact, few languages make it more than a couple hundred years without changing dramatically, if not becoming entirely unintelligible. Take English. There's this thing called Old English, right? And that's what Shakespeare spoke, yeah? It sounds all old-timey after all. Turns out, Shakespearean English is classified as Early Modern English. Before that was Middle English, and before that was Old English. Old English, true Old English, was spoken about 1,000 years ago, and it sounded almost nothing like modern English. There's an old epic poem called Beowulf, which was written originally in Old English. Translated into modern English, the first lines of the story go, "Lo, praise of the prowess of people kings, of spear-armed Danes." But in the original Old English, that same opening line would have sounded something like, "What we gardena in gardagum, feud kninga thrim yevrunun," which doesn't really sound like English at all. Really, the only decipherable piece there is king, which was kning. But over time, English went through a million small sound changes and eventually transformed into the different forms of English we see today. What I want you to keep in your mind is that it is natural for languages to change. When people talk about sound changes in languages, this is not a corruption. It's not wrong. It is the natural part of language change. And it's super cool. As it turns out, we're experiencing some sound changes right now. Some of which are happening countrywide, some are quite localized to the Pacific Northwest. So I'm here to talk about a couple sound changes that you are likely already doing. Sound change number one, T glottalization. To understand what T glottalization is, we must first talk about what glottalization is. Your glottis is essentially the gap between your vocal cords. A glottal stop is when you abruptly close your glottis, that is, shut your vocal folds suddenly. What's usually pointed to in English when looking for glottal stops is when you say uh-oh. That stop in between the and the O is a glottal stop. Fun fact, there was a glottal stop in the middle of the name of Chief Seattle, the man who the city of Seattle was named for. In his native Lushootse language, his name was pronounced something like si-ak. Now, if you're reading up on glottal stops, you'll probably hear that uh-oh is as far as English takes it. And depending on the dialect of English you speak, that might be true. It was certainly true for standard American English for most of its history. But things are changing. T glottalization is the process by which many of the T's in our words change to glottal stops. This largely happens in two places. The first is in the middle of words. Take a word like button. Most people living in the Pacific Northwest, like myself, will not articulate the T sound. The T becomes a glottal stop, leading to something closer to button. Notice there was no T sound there. Similarly, with the word mountain, you get something closer to mountain. The other place you see the sound change is with terminal T's and monosyllabic words. That is when a T ends a word with only one syllable. So take a word like eight. Many Pacific Northwestern English speakers are likely to say eight. They instead say eight. Similar with eat, feet, and meat. Again, notice the lack of a T sound. I'm going to stress this point again, because I think it is very important. This is not happening because we're ruining the language, or we're lazy young people who can't be bothered to speak properly. Languages undergo sound changes. Everywhere, always, in every human language, all the time, forever, no exceptions. Let's look back at the number 8. Maybe 100 years ago, in Pacific Northwest English, it was probably pronounced 8, like other places in the country or other dialects of English. And some might decry this as the end of the purity of the English language because a bunch of young people are saying 8. But as I mentioned in episode 3, that GH in 8 used to make a sound. English speakers used to pronounce it something like echt. And I'm here to say that if your dialect of English glottalizes your T's, then you are no more ruining the English language than English speakers who say eight instead of echt. Sound change number two, Canadian raising. Those crazy Canadians with their pasta and their letter Z and the way they say oot in a boot. They do say oot in a boot, right? Well, no, they do not. Incoming super long tangent that's going somewhere, I promise, please keep listening. Humans make use of a lot of different sounds to make their languages. Depending on the dialect of English you speak, you probably make around 40 unique sounds. You might have noticed that 40 is more than the 26 letters in the English alphabet. But remember, the letter A can, for example, make three sounds. And then you have things like the SH sound, which is made by a combination of letters. Add up all these sounds, and you get about 40. Some languages use as few as 11, and other languages can use well over 100. And there are far more than that if you tally up all of the unique sounds in all human languages. Some of the sounds that you won't find in English are quite close to English sounds. Others are very different and very foreign. When you hear a sound that doesn't exist in your first language, it can be tricky to replicate it. For example, the TH sound is notoriously difficult for non-native English speakers because the TH sound is actually kind of really rare in human languages, likely occurring in less than 10% of spoken languages. Similarly, many English speakers can't roll their R's because most dialects of English don't have that sound. What often happens in these cases is that the speaker adopting the new sound will map it onto a sound that does exist in their language. So non-native English speakers will often say things like thank you, or thank you, or thank you, as each of those sounds are close to the TH and might exist in their language. This happens for native English speakers as well. For example, when I was learning to speak Portuguese, if I had a word like respeito, it would come out as respeito or respeito because I couldn't do the rolled R, and it took a while until I learned to be able to do that and could better replicate the sound. A similar thing is happening with a boot. Canadians don't actually say a boot, but what they do say has a vowel sound that doesn't exist in standard American English. So Americans will map that sound onto a sound that exists in their dialect. They will map it onto the oo sound. Now, I'm not Canadian, so of course my attempt at replicating their pronunciation will sound very silly to their ears. But to the best of my ability, the way they would say the word about is closer to about. Take the American English ow, shift it up and more forward in the mouth, and you get oh. This is an example of Canadian raising. And for a while now, the vowels of speakers in Washington and Oregon have been shifting in this direction. Like T glottalization, Canadian raising only happens in certain places. For Pacific Northwest speakers, the common example given is for words that end with a hard G, like egg and bag. An extreme example of this shift would be speakers who say egg and bag. Not a lot of speakers are that extreme. But if you live in Washington or Oregon, odds are the way you pronounce those words places your vowels higher in your mouth than for many speakers in the rest of the country. The change is very subtle at this point, but the trend seems to be continuing. Odds are, a few generations down, Canadian raising will be the norm. Who knows? In 80 years, maybe other Americans will make fun of us, incorrectly thinking we go around saying, oot in a boot.